Hi, it's Dr. Jim DeCanto. I'm going to be discussing a tip to facilitate the insertion of a laryngoscope. In lieu of using the standard scissor maneuver, which only really engages the upper and lower indentation and opens the mouth, it doesn't contain the tongue into the floor of the mouth, so the insertion of the laryngoscope can be hampered by an overly large tongue, either due to macroglossia or possibly conditions such as angioedema. So I'm going to demonstrate the use of a tongue depressor. In this case, I'm using a dentistry stainless steel tongue depressor. I'm going to push the tongue into the floor of the mouth, which also opens the mouth very, very well. It distracts the mandible inferiorly and allows me to place the laryngoscope over the top of the tongue depressor itself. I'm going to go into the vallecula, and now I'm going to remove the tongue depressor. What I'm going to be talking about is something I call the micro skills of laryngoscopy, in which I position the laryngoscope when it's in the patient's hypopharynx using two hands. I use my free hand to actually pinch this flange in order to control depth and laterality of the laryngoscope. I'll begin by deliberately overshooting the larynx, and we're going to be looking straight now down now at the posterior commissure and esophagus. I've overshot the epiglottis, and I'm looking at the cone of the posterior commissure, the interretinoid notch, cone of larynx. I'm going to go ahead and begin by pinching the flange and backing it up while maintaining the lifting pressure with my left hand. I'll reduce my lifting pressure, but perform the maneuvering of the laryngoscope itself with the free hand to move it millimeter by millimeter. Now that I can see the tip of the epiglottis, I can use my free hand with this little pinching maneuver to push it into the vallecula while modulating the lifting pressure so that I am appropriately sliding over the base of tongue and into the vallecula. I'm going to go ahead and give myself a nice grade one view on video laryngoscopy and on direct laryngoscopy. So in summary, by using the free hand, we can facilitate both direct and video laryngoscopy. I'm going to discuss a very specific problem in tracheal tube advancement over an airway intubating catheter or bougie. I'll place my metallic stylet into the mannequin model, and this is the right corniculate, left corniculate. This is the posterior commissure or interretinoid notch. Typically, the tracheal tube will impinge on the right corniculate cartilage very close to the posterior commissure. We'll show that to you in close-up now. Because we're using left-cut bevel tracheal tubes in the modern day and age, as the tracheal tube is advanced along the bougie, a small gap can occur during the passage of the tracheal tube. This gap is known to trap the right corniculate cartilage and essentially stop the advancement of the tracheal tube. The maneuver to perform should you trap the tracheal tube on the cartilaginous structures of the larynx is to disengage from the cartilaginous structures and perform a counterclockwise leftward turn of the tracheal tube to minimize the gap and re-advance this into the larynx. We are essentially putting the Murphy eye from the 3 o'clock position to the 12 o'clock position in order to minimize the gap. I'll go ahead and simulate, I'm impinging now on the right corniculate and the posterior commissure of the larynx, and I'm unable to advance the tracheal tube. The fix for this is to disengage from the cartilaginous structure, turn the tracheal tube so that the Murphy eye is pointing at the 12 o'clock position, 12 o'clock or top position, and re-advance the tracheal tube over the posterior commissure and into the trachea. We're going to discuss using a preloaded bougie technique in order to perform the intubation. This is a technique that has been called the KiwiD. It's a procedure that allows a single practitioner much more latitude and less need for an assistant. What we've done, which is different from the Kiwi grip is where we hold the tail of the bougie ourselves, is we're utilizing the existence of the Murphy eye to hold a loop in the tracheal tube, which exposes the business end, the usable end of the bougie, while I can manipulate the tip in many different directions. It also frees up my hands for the process of using suction or doing other procedures. I'll begin by performing the laryngoscopy on the mannequin. I want to make sure I get to that vallecula and expose that larynx. What I can now do is deliver the bougie with a simple motion of the arm, remove the tail of the bougie, and then advance the tracheal tube with a leftward twist to avoid impingement on the right corniculate cartilage. I'll now grasp the tracheal tube and remove the bougie myself with this technique. Should the optics become contaminated, either because of I'm not aggressive enough with suctioning or because of a spurt of airway contaminant, I have another choice with this particular device. It is a Macintosh-shaped video laryngoscope that does permit direct laryngoscopy. I'm looking at the larynx now. I'm looking at the posterior commissure. Now I have a grade one view. Should I have soiling of the optics beyond direct laryngoscopy, I can very rapidly change the blade using a disposable system. I'll ask my assistant to come forward, open up our, I'm going to leave the suction in the patient while I do this, and we're going to rapidly change out our blades. Very nice. And now I'm back in business.